Fluffy McFlowflues, what's up everybody? How you doing? Today's video is going to be a little different than what I've usually done, given that my channel is about things I enjoy doing, which tends to be working on my bikes or my Grumman step van, or lately it's in prepping my metal workshop in the backyard. But another thing I love doing is playing music. And for those of you that don't know, I've been an electric bass player for quite a long time now. Doesn't necessarily mean I'm that good, it just means I like doing it. I have been in bands since I was a teen. I'm now like in my mid-50s. When I lived in Greece, I had a band there that we'd play twice a month, make some extra money and have some fun. Hot Rod Junkies. Athens, Greece, baby. I'll put the link below. You can watch some videos on YouTube. So that's one thing I really love doing. And in playing my basses, I've also built one, which you'll see in a moment. I really like having unique instruments. I also like dressing them up so that they look the way that I like. So here's a case in point. This bass, this is an 8-string bass. So what you have is four double courses of strings. So you've got octave strings that match up with the fatter string. So that's kind of neat, right? Gives you a full sound, similar to like a 12-string guitar, let's say, or a bouzouki. Foreshadowing. And this one was made by Carlo Robelli. For those that don't know, Carlo Robelli basses were, I think, started sometime in the 60s, 70s. And they were actually considered very good, quite expensive instruments. If you find some of those online, they're pretty pricey. Later on in the name of the life of that name, I should say, the name rights to the name got sold, if I'm not mistaken, to a East Coast music store called Sam Ash. They're a large chain. Family owned, but they've gotten quite big, similar to a Guitar Center, let's say. And the Carlo Robelli name became their house brand. They made electric basses, acoustic guitars, violins. They may have even made cellos and upright basses. I'm not 100% sure. Now, keep in mind, these were considered very cheap. I think this thing new, I got it on a discount because it was missing one of the knobs. I mean, the potentiometer was there, but the knob was gone. I think I got this thing for under $200. I have another Carlo Robelli bass. If you watch those Hot Rod Junkie videos, you'll see it there. It's got flames on it, and I've customized that one a bit. That one was under $200, but these things rock. They're solidly made. They have really awesome, stable, good-feeling necks. The electronics in here, this is an active bass, so is my other one. Just incredible. They sound fantastic. What you've got here is a low, mid, and a high EQ adjustment. That's your master volume. And then you have this one soap bar pickup close to the bridge. I kind of wish this pickup was a little closer to the center, a little closer to the neck, but it's okay. I can play with the EQ enough to get the sound I like out of it, but I think it would still, always sounds a little, let's say, thin, tinny when it's down by the bridge, in my opinion. But again, you can fuss with the EQs and get a nice full sound. I've even recorded with this one and my other one. I've recorded with them, and the sound engineers were just blown away at how good the thing sounds, especially when it's going to the board. They thought it would just sound like crap, but it does not. So for all you naysayers, say nay no more. On this one, I put these knobs on. I changed them out. But another thing I've done, which is the focus of today's video, is I installed these are stickers, right? So 3rd fret, 5th fret, 7th, 9th, and the 12th here, and continuing on. These are called inlay stickers, and they're made by a company called Jockomo. I'll put that link right here so you can see that, and I'll put it in the description as well. And these are a special type of vinyl sticker that you can install them on your fretboard and also on fingerboards. They make ones for fretless basses that have a continuous pattern, and you'll see what I mean later as we work on this one. The nice thing about them is if you don't tell people they're stickers, you absolutely cannot tell, right? Let me give you another example. This is a Harley Benton, inexpensive. I love inexpensive basses that are awesome because I just love making people realize the price doesn't always matter. This was a $90 precision bass kit from a company called Harley Benton. That's the house brand of Thomann in Germany. I'll put their link right there. Harley Benton are very cheap, meaning price-wise, electric basses, electric guitars. I think they also make acoustic contrabasses. I'm not sure if they make other stuff too. Yeah, this was a $90 kit I had bought when I lived in Greece, and then I brought it with me to the States. And when I built it, I decided to do an homage to the Ampeg scroll bass, which I absolutely love. So you can see here, I reshaped the body using the template of an Ampeg bass body that somebody had sent me online. Don't remember who you are, but thank you so much. And then I drew out this F hole, cut it out. The headstock was just a big paddle that I then, I'm blocking the light. I chose this shape. I drew that out, cut a little F hole in there too, right? Added this 3-string retainer. Black Aurora strings. I love Aurora. I'll put their link below. They make strings that are different colors. You can get them natural color too. These are, for me, they're round wound strings. Some of the best sounding, longest lasting strings I've used in years. They're on every bass I can get them for, I put them on. They didn't make a set for the 8-string. So those are, I don't remember what brand exactly. Anyway, I built this thing. I could do a video on this another time. But the main point is these blocks, these are inlay stickers, right? This came with dots and I wanted blocks because I thought it would look better. Well, check them out. Here they are, right? My buddy was just over today. He's a very avid guitarist, been playing for 30 plus years, and he had no idea those were stickers. So they're not cheap looking at all. The other nice feature of these Jockomo inlay stickers, and by the way, I'm not sponsored or anything, I just really like their product. You don't really feel them, and they don't get in the way of playing. So like if you're bending, they make them for guitars too, and acoustic guitars and ukuleles. If you're bending strings or whatever, it's not gonna catch on the sticker and tear or get in your way or change the tone or anything like that. And furthermore, they're very long lasting. These have been on here for, I built this bass in 2015. It's now 2023. I've played it a lot. I've played it live. I've played it in rehearsals. You can't even tell, right? So getting back to this one, at the time I put these on, it must have been about 2010, no later than 2012. So they're at the very least 11 years old. I've played this thing extensively live, rehearsals, at home, just piddling around. There's no problems, no damage to the stickers. They're not peeling off or anything. But that's another beautiful thing about these. They're designed that when you're ready to peel them off, they come off easily. If they leave any residue, glue residue, you're told on their website, on their FAQ site, use olive oil. I'll just use a little lemon oil, perhaps, but I'd rather not use any oil. They even do recommend that if you have lemon oiled or some other type of oil, your neck or your fretboard, I'm so sorry, you should wait, you know, several weeks to a couple of months for it to soak in totally. But once the stickers are on and they're secure, then you can lemon oil your fretboard or fingerboard and not have any issues. It's just getting them to stick ahead of time. So I haven't treated this fretboard in a while. It's about time I do. It's very dry here in New Mexico. But before I do that, what I really want to do is I love these stickers, but I decided to get a different set. So I'm gonna, today on this video, it's taken me a while to get to the point, we're gonna remove these Jockomo stickers and see how that goes. And then I have purchased a set of these flame stickers. And what you do is, they have instructions in the package we'll look at later, that they will run just about the full length of the neck. And anyone that knows me knows I'm a sucker for fully inlaid fretboards. Just something about it. I have a Traben Phoenix base where the fretboard is all flames. I just love it. Yeah, this design's okay. It came in like a pearl, mother of pearl type finish. They also had a finish that looked like real flames. They've got another one called Tree of Life, and yet another called cherry blossom, like Japanese cherry blossoms. Again, these on this base were just inlays to look like a Fender Jazz bass, right? They even have originally, I really like these, take a peek, I put it on the back here, you see that star? That's one of their stickers. I had it on the fretboard on the dots, and I put the stars, but I decided to go with something else and ended up going with the blocks, right? So that's what we're gonna do today. I've got some my work area set up. I'll set the camera up and we'll go do that, and I have a few other things to show you, and let's just see how it goes. All right, let's get started. Okay, I lied. I wanted to show you one more thing. It's got nothing to do with the stickers. Although, I was just looking at this thing, and because Jockomo does make continuous stickers that don't have any breaks in them, which you'll see when we do that for fretless instruments, I'm thinking about getting something and applying it to the fingerboard here just for looks. But this is my Harley Benton electric upright bass. They don't actually make this one anymore. I think this was called the EUB for electric upright bass 500. Look at this beautiful machine. I just love it for its physicality. It's got a scroll headstock. It's got a nice shape to the body rather than most that are just like a little stick, right? There's a, they call them piezo, but I call it piezo, because it's a Greek word, piezo, that I press or I push. So it's a piezo pickup under the feet of this bridge that picks up the resonance. I've done a lot of modifications to this thing. I will do another video if I get a lot of interest in the Carlo Robelli sticker that I'm doing. Maybe I'll do some rundowns on my instruments, but I just wanted you to take a peek at this lovely, lovely machine. I love it. I haven't played this live yet, but I really want to. Anyway, thought you would enjoy. Now let's get set up and started for these stickers. Okay. All right, well, the first thing we're gonna do here is loosen all the strings. I don't need to completely remove them, but we need to loosen them so we can get them out of the way. If you notice here, I bought this, it's like a neck block protector. I don't do a ton of work, so if I did, I'd probably get a different one. This is just a block of wood cut in these different shapes with some felt for support. They have much nicer ones, but I was looking for something inexpensive, so I got this on eBay just to give me something to support my instrument necks with, because I do my own setups on my instruments and things like this, right? So I've got that. This is my coffee table, which is actually a trunk. I just put a cloth on it for a little bit of cushion. And then check this out. Have you ever heard of a plastic razor blade. I never had, but I was looking for a way to get some stickers off my car that were there when I bought it. And somebody in a video mentioned plastic razor blades, so I looked on eBay and I found this contraption. It's just a scraper, you know, you pull this cap off. And for now, right now, I have a metal regular razor blade in there. You just loosen that knob and take it out. But it also came with a pack of, I don't know, like 20 of these plastic razor blades. So you can use this to scrape things on your painted car or now on my fretboard. And it should neither gouge the wood nor should it ruin paint. So it's kind of neat, huh? I'll put a link for that in the description, just because it's probably going to be too long to just write on the screen. But just look up plastic razor blade or plastic razor blade and scraper. So we shall loosen all 8 of these strings, and that won't harm the instrument. People sometimes freak out about taking the tension off your neck, but it's really not going to be a big deal, at least not in this case. Oh, I'm seeing too, I don't know if you could see that, but this tuning peg is quite loose. Can you see that? Let me zoom you in. It's hard to get this, oh, look at my foot! It's hard to get this a good angle on doing this. Hang on, I'm sorry. I can't see what's going on. For some reason, it got super dark. How odd. Here, let me do this instead. See, that's really loose. It's shaking. It's like, it'll give me a chance to take care of stuff like that as well. It's weird how it got dark. What is that all about? Do you know? I don't know. If you know, let me know. Okay, I'll put you back here. There you go. There you go. Zoom in a little. It's gonna get dark again. I know, I could be better at this. I need an assistant. I did just get 600 subscribers. Thank you, everybody. Thank you dearly. Yeah, this fretboard is dirty and dry. So, after I put the new stickers on, it'll be a good chance to clean as well as oil. When I bought this base too, so here's a story. I had this base and then the flame base I mentioned too, the Carlo Robelli flame base. And just before I moved to Greece, I had this bright idea that I was gonna lighten my load. So I sold a bunch of things, like my lathe, and those two bases. The moment I got to Greece, I regretted it. So I went on Craigslist while in Greece. I went on the US Craigslist site and found this base and that flame base. They weren't mine. They were just the same models. And I purchased them. I had them sent. Both of them delivered to my sister's house in New York. And then I had a friend of mine go get them and ship them to me in Greece. So, okay, this one's loose too. I don't know if you can see that, but take my word for it. So I must have paid double what they were worth by doing that. Definitely a lot more than I paid. I got for them, I'm sorry, when I sold them. But I just missed them so much, and they were really just such good instruments that I regretted it immediately and realized the error of my ways right away. So that's how good these basses are and how much I like them. I want to start collecting the Carlo Robellis, to be honest, the inexpensive ones. But I've noticed lately their prices are just going through the roof. People are like, Anyway, the other thing was when I got this, the smaller pegs, which are for the thinner strings, one of them was broken. So I just bought some guitar tuners that matched. And ooh, that one's loose too. That one's very loose. That one's slightly loose. And I installed it and it took care of the problem. So, all right. So before I'm gonna unpeel these, I wanna open this package. Let's get you in a little closer so you can see what I'm doing. Right? You with me? So you can see here it says Fire Flames WS. I don't know what that means. For base. Maybe white sticker. You'll see them on the site there. Part FB105 Frank FF-WTF-100. So let's open them up. Their shipping is quick. They have a lot of choices. Go on their website, see what they've got. They've got stuff for sound holes on acoustics, headstocks. Ooh, this got dark again. I'm gonna turn you off and turn you back on. That's better. Like I was saying, sound holes for ukuleles and acoustic guitars, headstocks, truss rod covers, fretboards, fingerboards, also just some neat accent stickers. They used to have as well. I bought it but never used it. It's like a sticker about this big. You can put on the body and then it's tacky, and then you can stick like your picks to it. So if you drop a pick, you can just grab it off of the body of your instrument. Never tried it, so I can't say whether it was good or not. Okay, I'm having a little trouble here. Jockomo. Come on. There we go. So there's the sheet. And here are the instructions. There's this myth that like men don't read instructions. Maybe some don't. I know plenty of women that don't either. I read instructions. Okay, so here are the instructions. It shows you the layout starting from, it says zero, so that's where your nut would be, in first fret, second fret, etc. Step one, using a pick or nail, squeegee the entire decal surface. Apply pressure to surface. Do not remove transfer tape. So I guess there's transfer tape on top of this. So they're talking about before you remove them. Oh, I feel it. There's a clear transfer tape on here on top of this. So you squeegee that, which I can probably use one of those razor blades or maybe a credit card. I have a squeegee too for body work. Then it says remove backing paper, so that would be the paper on the back here. Once you are satisfied with the position, that's step three. So step three is being satisfied. I like that. Step four, apply the sticker. Apply pressure with fingers, working from the center to the edge. And then step five, carefully peel away the transfer tape. So we can do all that. And then you see here, they give you the drawing. That is the first sticker on the first fret, so that would be this one, right? You see that? And then that's the next one, and so on and so forth. So that's from the first fret down. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, sixth, yes, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and then this big one is your 12th fret. And then you carry on, my wayward son. And then on the bottom here is like a final sticker that if you look here with this set, I had put that one there. I may or may not do that, but just showing you what's there. Oops, the rest of my house. So I'm gonna shut you off for a moment. I'm gonna go get my squeegee and we'll work on that right here. All right, hang on. All right, I've got a few tools here. This is just like a wooden board I've had for years. I used it when I was leather working. I prefer if it was smooth. It's not. It's got like little chunks taken out of it, but I think I can make it work. These are the, you can get these at any auto store. They're for body working on vehicles. They are, I was going to say squeegees. What does Mr. Jockomo call them? Squeegee. There you go. But you get, you can do body work. You can see there's some old Bondo on here. So I'm gonna use these, right? So what we're trying to do, I'm not sure if you can see it, but this clear transfer paper is bubbled up over the sticker. So you wanna get that nice and smooth. You want it to adhere to the pearlescent top of the sticker that's gonna be attached to the instrument. I hope it, you need to put good pressure. I was gonna say I hope it adheres decently well. The nice thing with these plastic squeegees is they put pressure, but you don't have the fear that you're gonna tear anything. Like right here, they're peeling up. I don't know if it's kind of hot. It's in the 90s today, and I don't have my swamp cooler on. But we'll just take our time. The other thing I'm gonna do, well, you'll see. And we can revisit this for each one individually as we work on it. So, I'm okay with that for the moment. I don't think they're gonna hold too well. But anyway, next step, I want to cut each one separately off, right, from the backing paper. So I want to number each one so I don't get confused. So we're going to, following this diagram, we see which is number one, which is number two, etc. So I'm certain here, looking at this, that's for the first fret. So I'm just going to put a 1 and then a 2. You see the, you know which, where the separation is? Because the off string taught us that you have to keep them separated. You got that space, that space, that space. So that's where your fret would be, right? So that's 3. This is 4. And you see number 4 here has like 3 separate pieces. So moving on, number 5. That's number 5. And then we've got number 6. I'm sorry, 1, 2. Oh, they start at 0, okay. But we see here, I'm saying 6. They're saying between 5 and 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. This is going to be a little tricky, 16, because there's a lot of separate little pieces, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22. And you also have to measure, it's on their website, because there are different scale lengths of instruments. So you need to measure your instrument to make sure that these stickers will fit that scale length. Now, did I do that? No. So let's see what happens. But I'm willing to give it a shot. Okay. Let's carry on. On the Jockomo site, it tells you that you may want to heat up these older stickers made with a warm cloth or something to help peel them. I'm just going to try it as is because, like I just said, it's a very warm day here. So I'm going to use my plastic razor. Huh, coming right up. After all these years, thank you for your service. I appreciate you being in my life, you stickers. Ooh, bad fret wear right there. All right. Well, that's nice. That came right off. Can you see it? It's still quite sticky. And there is some residue. Let me bring you in and show you. you can, why is my, it keeps going dark. You can see the shape of the sticker, and it is tacky, but I think it'll clean up pretty easily by just, I don't know, maybe a little rubbing, maybe a little scraping. I just don't want to oil this with olive oil, like they said, or lemon oil, and then have to wait weeks. You know, the nice thing is, though, there's a good chance the new sticker is going to cover that. We'll cross that bridge when we come to it. I do have some, like, acetone or lighter fluid. Part of me doesn't want to have that touch the wood, but part of me thinks it'll be just fine if I use a very little bit and careful with it. Okay, let's just continue and do these. If I run across anything worth noting, I'll let you know. I will say that this plastic razor blade is working wonders. Who knew? I bet you I could reuse these on something else. They're coming off that well. All right. Voila. All right. Okay, so they did all leave, not all of them, most of them left residue. It's not horrible, but it does need to be addressed. I'm gonna go get some acetone because, hey, that's how I roll. Now, I got some lighter fluid, actually. I didn't have acetone. It should work. Contains naphtha. I think it'll be okay. If anything, too, it'll clean off any dirt and grime on the fretboard. And then after the stickers are applied, I will lemon oil. So let me zoom you in. We can take a look at that one. Why? I'm zooming in and it's just getting darker. What's going on, kids? What's that all about? Anyone know? Let me change some settings. I changed the settings. It was on automatic white balance. Now I have it on tungsten. Wow, I don't know what that's all about. That really stinks. I'm so sorry. Let's see. What if I cleaned my lens. Maybe a little liquid got inside the, I don't know. That's as close as I feel I can get. Sorry about that. I got an old sock here. So it's right there. I'll talk you through it. I'm putting a little lighter fluid on the sock. And, opa. I'm just going to rub it. Came right off. That's it. You can still kind of see the outline of the where the sticker was. I'll show you. Can you see that? But there's no more glue there, and it cleaned up the fret a little too. I can see. So I'm just gonna do that to all of them, and then work on applying the stickers. Let me set you back up on the tripod, change out the battery, and we'll just keep doing that. You know what the cool thing is right now? I could do the Jimi Hendrix, right? Light it on fire. Be like, whoa, voodoo child, voodoo child. You know what I mean? Anyway, carry on. All right, the glue's all gone. And it's nice too, this stuff evaporates really quickly. Now I'm just gonna go back and do every fret, because I like it, I just like it. I'm gonna clean all the grime off. And you can see I really only applied very little and it's doing most of it. So let's keep going. Grime be gone.
Eventually.
All right, that's all done. Let's move on. Next step, start cutting those out. Okay, next step, get this out of here. And this. Now, what I'm gonna do is take my scissor, fret marker one, I wanna cut around pretty close, but not really too close to the sticker, and then carefully cut between. That's gonna be tricky. I don't wanna cut the sticker, right? I just wanna cut the paper around it. There's just a really narrow gap between the frets, so you gotta be careful. All right, we got that. And then this would go here, like this. I'm not gonna glue it down yet, because if I go a little off center, then I'll have a problem when we get down here and you've got the multiple pieces that you know, aren't connected to anything. It'll maybe too easy to mess it up. Let's go on to number two. I'm just gonna slice all these carefully, not to cut the sticker. If I can do this, you can do this. And then we'll go up here like this. And I've learned you want to cut it close enough. I've learned this from using other stickers, that you can still place it on the fret somewhat reasonably. So you can try and position it as best you can. If you look here, you can see how they sort of connect. It's kind of neat. Oh, does that go like this? No, that's gonna be tricky. Three, and then, oh, you know, I didn't remember, this doesn't actually have dots on the face of it. I think that's why I originally got the Jockomo stickers. Oh, I forgot all about that. How neat. Okay, here's number four. And number five. Oh, I gotta trim this. Can even do that. So you kind of want that in the middle, which means that's gotta move over. So it takes a little doing. Man, these frets are really chewed up. I just noticed that. I don't know if I did that or I bought this used, obviously, from somebody. Interesting. Okay, five. As the frets get smaller, it'll get even trickier. Let's go. If you can't see, you tell me. Six. Seven. Pretty cool. Is it somewhat juvenile? Yeah. Do I care? No. Okay, 8. As far as I'm concerned, you just do what you want. It's your instrument. I remember I like putting multicolored strings on my various basses, like that Harley Benton Ampeg tribute bass I built. So I put the black strings on it, on my other Carlo Robelli with the flames I mentioned. I put red strings on it because it matches the bass. And I remember going to a gig and some dude like, "Oh, you have red strings on your bass?" And I was like, "I sure do." And I think he thought he was so much better than me, especially. Now, 9 here. This would make sense because the face is that way, but it almost looked like it could flip the other way. But you see how the numbers are all oriented in the same direction? So that's how I know that it's in the right, it's facing the right way. That's kind of neat. Do you like it? Let me know. Just curious. Just curious what people's tastes are. I'll be right back. I want the strings to stay completely off the fretboard. I've loosened them quite a bit, but they still want to pop back up just because of the bridge. So I have these plastic clips, like safety pins. I'm just gonna do that, or maybe that. Let's see if I can get them to stay off without harming anything. Maybe this way. No. Hey, it was worth a shot. No. Here? Nope. Down here? It just doesn't have a lot of pinchiness. Pinchy cabronness. I'll be right back. Let's try round 2. These are stronger clamps from Harbor Freight. They're plastic. I call the other thing safety pins, I think, and I meant to call them something else. What are they called? Something else other than safety pins. My brain gave out. All right, look at that. Okay, carry on. 12. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. What I'm also doing is the dots on the side of the neck. 3, 5, 7, 9, 12. Okay. Let's carry on. Going to 13. The backing paper's too big, so it won't sit well, but the sticker itself does, so that's good. So it looks like this was made for this scale base. We'll see. Another thing I could have done is measured here and here and drawn like a pencil line down the center. I still could. because we're just placing these by eye right now. But it does kind of snake around, so I don't think that would matter. So this has 24 frets, so there's two less. So I may put that on just to kind of fill up that empty space. I'll decide at the end. All right, so there's our layout. What do you think? What I believe I'm gonna do, because if you look here, number one is off center. Let me center you on top of the base here, so you can see what I'm talking about. Are you bored? Are you having a good time? Okay, so see, first fret, it's not in the center. It's off center because like that's the center point of the sticker, right? But it comes this way, so it kind of snakes around. So what I think I'm gonna do is the 12th fret kind of takes up almost the entire area. Hang on, I'm gonna turn off this light. That's part of the problem. It's dark now, more intimate, right? So the 12th fret takes up the whole space. So if I center that one and have it in a good spot, then I can build off of that, you know, and work my way up, because that one has to be centered. The 5th fret too, it's kind of a bigger piece. But I think if I start at 12, work my way up to 1, and then back down to 22, I think that's the way to go. All right, I'll put you back on the stand, turn the light back on, and let's get started. All right, let's get started. I'm just going over the tips again. Squeegee, done. Remove backing paper. Didn't do that yet. Then we'll be satisfied with the position, apply the stick or apply pressure with fingers working from the center to the edge. So, a couple things. Wash your hands. I had a little grease on my hands from touching a tool. I washed them. They're dry. There's nothing greasy or whatever on there. Also, I'm going to try a trick I see online. They don't do it with the plastic razor. Who knew? But they'll use a metal razor and like unstick this and like hold it on the edge of the razor to place it, because it's easier than like having your fat finger in there, you know. Another thing is I have these forceps. I got these from a dentist years ago. Well, usually they throw out their old tools that they can't use anymore. They're still good for this type of work. I use these for motorcycle work, this type of work, anything you need. You can get all sorts of dental tools. Ask your dentist. 9 out of 10 agree. Okay, so I'm just kind of eyeballing the edge of this with the edge of this, not confusing the paper, the white paper. Okay, so I'm going to peel the backing paper off. This is always a little difficult. When you peel this backing paper off, what you want is the inlay to stay on the clear adhesive. That was the first step we did, if you remember. So, and then I'm trying not to touch where the glue is on the inlay. I'm putting that there, kind of cutting the difference between this edge and that edge between the frets, and then eyeballing where the corners are. I think I'm okay with that. It's just sitting on there on its own weight. What I may do is leave it, right? Because I can easily peel it back off. And let's move on. How's that sound? We'll do the next one just the same way. Just kind of lay it down there until we're happy, and then we can squeegee each one in place. So let's go to 12. Now I can work off of these points. So then I'm just going to try and get it centered between the two frets, but then work off of these points as far as the left-right positioning, or the up-down positioning, I'm sorry. Get it? Let's do it. Okay. This is the hardest part. You need nails for this, which I do have. So as you're peeling this backing paper off, if the inlay stickers don't stay on there, you have to re-squeegee, which I have to do here. Sometimes it helps too if, like, you peel it at an angle. Let's try again. There we go. And it's the smaller ones, you really want to be careful. Nice. I'll grab it from here this time. Oh. That bad boy stuck. But it was the transfer paper that stuck, not the inlay. Don't like it. Part of it's my glasses. I'm okay with that. Keep going. I think what I might do, just to be on the safe side, is squeegee each one before I peel it. Might save me some time. My back hurts from hunching over like this. Nope. Can't get it. There it is. There we go. This way. I'm just tapping, not on the colored part where the inlay is, but the clear one, just enough to kind of hold it there, right? But I'm happy, and look, I'm being a little bit of a perfectionist, but you kind of have to be. But also, it's really minute. Unless you make a huge, huge mistake, I don't think anyone will ever notice, right? There we go. Oh, what I was saying before, like, you can take a razor and, like, you'll rest it on the tip of the razor like this and place it, but I have more control with this. Resting my hand to, without pressing the stickers, to get more control. There we go. Nope, nope. kind of helps. I'm resting the side of the forceps on the fret, so I can get it really close without it sticking at all. Nope. The hard part is getting resting my hand so it's not shaking. There we go. That's okay. I like it.
2,000 years later.
All right. First fret. It's kind of cool. All right, I'll take it. Going this way. So I think you get the picture. I'm gonna just move on. I'll do the rest, and then I'll come back for the next step in the process. It's looking good though, looking at it from here. Oh, I really like it. I didn't know if I would like the flames. They're okay. They're not my favorite. The pattern of the flames, I mean, or the shape of the flames, but it's all right. Or I'll bring you back soon. Okay, they're all laid in place, but very lightly. I haven't adhered anything permanently. I'm happy with it. There's nothing glaringly terrible. They're as straight as I could get them. I didn't put that this one in yet. I'm still undecided. You see, with just these on, I feel like at a glance it looks like it was made that way. With that on there, that just kind of, I don't want to say cheapens it, but kind of gives it away, let's say. I may just save that for something else. But yeah, I'm happy with it. I really liked starting here on the 12th fret and moving up and then back down, because it gave me a really good starting point, because as you can see, it snakes around, right? So they're not all in a straight line, but I'm happy with it. So the next part, I'll bring you on the other side, is that clear transfer paper is still on there. I'm now going to take the plastic razor blades. Those things sure did come in handy. Handy. Let's bring in just a little bit more. And I'm just going to take them and start. It says to use your fingers. So I may, you know, start with that, just get everything down, and then just lightly. I don't want to press too hard, although this transfer paper is quite durable. You can press on it, so I want to do that, but I'm not like digging into it, you know. Number one, because the better they stick now, the better they'll be for their lifetime. If you don't get good adhesion now, they will peel off eventually, or faster, or even right away. No bubbles, no toils or troubles. Nice. There's a couple of spots here where, like that clear transfer paper, I cut it as close to the flame as I could, but it's still overhanging and slightly touching the fret. So when I peel the transfer paper off, we're going to go over this again and without the transfer paper on, and more delicately but firmly with our fingers, likely press down on the sticker to make sure that it's on there. I'm doing the initial sticking with my finger so I can feel for any bubbles. And then moving on with the razor, plastic razor blade. Who knew? My goodness. If you knew, let me know. I'd never heard of that before, all these years. All right. You get the picture? I'm just going to keep going then. I will say the bigger pieces obviously are much easier to put in place. These teeny tiny ones were a little tricky. All right. All right. So I've gone around and I've adhered all of them. The transfer tape is still on there. I made a little screw up here. I wasn't paying attention. The 13th fret one is a little too far that way towards the bridge. So it looks like that right there of the inlay sticker is on the fret. Let's see what I can do about that. But they're all down, they're all adhered. Yeah, I had adhered it tightly without noticing. And then I noticed the problem, so it was too late to try and unstick it. Because if you unstick these after they're on the fretboard, it could tear, but more so like it curls and it loses some of its stickiness. And then I don't want to risk it not adhering well. Okay, let's try this with you in my left hand. I'm just grabbing the corner of that clear. Alright. Lifting it up and carefully, especially on those points. Oh, you see that point didn't stick. Did you see that? It was lifting up. So I have to stick that back down. What helps too sometimes is go from the other side. You want like to go from the wider pattern to the thinner. So this little one didn't stick either. But if I do this and then pull towards me, there's a good chance it'll stay because you're pulling on the wider. See that? So I know we're going to go back over and press all these down, but that's it. So that's the clear tape off, and that's there. Looks all right. Try the next one. So all these points, I'd be better off going in that direction. Let's see if I can get it started. That's why I have to be careful with these. You know, good adhesion, clean fretboard. Can you see? There we go. There we go. It's peeling up. Nice. You go nice and slow. All right. All right. Good. Two down, 21 to go. Well, all right, we're done with that. We're almost done overall though. So now, let's take a look up close. They're all on, all right. I just have to address that. I don't know if you can really see. I'm going to take this very sharp X-Acto knife and pressing hard enough to cut that, but not so hard as to gouge the wood. I'm going to cut that just a little bit because I don't want to have any issues in the future with it not adhering or something. Can you see? I can barely see. My glasses that I'm wearing kind of suck for this. I want to cut it a little back too, to be further away from the fret. The tricky part is not gouging the wood, which it looks like I've done. Did I get it? There it is. Can you see that little piece? There it is. Also trying not to gouge the... Can you see it? It's right there. All right, and then we're gonna take our handy dandy and push it down carefully. Perfect. Like it never happened. I'm seeing a slight bubble right there. Alright, so just take your time. Not too hard. Gonna rub them all down. So this is why now, like I mentioned earlier, this neck really needs oiling, lemon oil. But I'm not gonna do that right now. I'm gonna wait. I wanna rub these down, let them settle in. I'm gonna play it a bunch, right? So it, the strings press down on them. I'm gonna use this, but instead of sharply angling it, I'm gonna have a very soft angle. So I'm not digging in with the edge, more pressing. Because this will screw it up, I'm telling you right now. Oh, see, I did it right there. See how it lifted it? Alright. Alright, back to the finger method, forget it. But that's how things are, folks. You have a plan, but then sometimes things get in the way, and you really have to modify your plan, such as life, right? So, it's good to have a plan, but we always have to have wiggle room that that plan might not go exactly the way we envisioned. It happens all the time. That's something I live my life by, in case you're wondering. I like to plan for the future, but then always leave plenty of wiggle room. Or at least be prepared for if things don't go well, that you're gonna have to change the plan on the spot. Man, this thing needs a good fret dressing. I know just the man to do it. Okay, see these little teeny tiny tips, TTTs, you have to be careful. That's why I'm not gonna lemon oil this right away. Listen to me, your Uncle Khan, he knows. He knows stuff. All right, I see it's one little spot here that's not stick, I can't get my finger on, so I'm just pressing ever so slightly with the plastic razor blade. I can't listen to music, but it's playing in my head. The little ones are the hardest. Only go in one direction. Don't go back and forth because that'll lift it. And again, don't press too hard. I'm seeing little teeny bubbles. A couple spots. These smaller ones, hard to get my fingers on it. So I'm using this thing. But they're also the ones that are easiest to lift. Pushing always in one direction. One direction. Like the band. Although in the end, they went different directions. Well, I think we're done. Look at that. Not too bad. I'll take a standing shot in a moment. Clean up the mess. But next, I just want to address the loose issues. So what we need is a wrench for these nuts. We need a little screwdriver for the end there. And then there's Phillips screws on the other side of this. So let's get to that. Let me get my tools. All right, so in checking, all of these are moving, all of them, right? So the first thing I want to do is check the screws on the back. and see. Actually, the first thing I'm going to do is kind of put all the strings back where they belong, but I'm not going to tighten them. I just want them in place just to kind of square that away. All right. Get them to sit in the nut, but I do want them loose so that I can tighten the tuners. Just putting them into place ever so carefully. Put a happy tree over here. All right, let's go. We're over here. Try not to bend them. You don't want that to happen. Good. And good. And good. We're sitting on the bridge. Okay. Back up there. Oh, wrong way. Where are you going? Alright. I'm going to carefully flip this over. And then if you look, there are these little Phillips head screws. What that one is I told you one of these broke. So the guitar tuner one I got, the original ones, you see how they have that little tab right there where it's screwed into? This did not, but I didn't want to get rid of the screw, so I just threw it back in there. Oh, and this one broke too. Now I remember two of them broke. So first thing I'm going to do is tighten these Allen head screws with one of these screwdrivers. I'm going to check them all. You want to be careful too, because even though these are black, the paint will come off pretty easily. You don't want to over tighten these, right, because you don't want to strip the holes. If you ever do strip a hole in these in wood like this, what you can do, and I've done this for testing these. Okay, nice and snug. This one needs a little more. What you can do is, I've done that a bit with where the strap attaches. If you take a little wood glue, you don't even need the glue sometimes, and then you put a toothpick, a wooden toothpick, or two or three in there, however many you need. Put them in the hole, and then just put your screw back in. Those will kind of take up the space, and voila, it's filled. Might not be like, I've had it last for years, but there may be a better way to do it. Okay, so these are tight, so they're not shaking as much. This one is, but it's from here. A little screw on the end of here, which I'll show you in a moment. But the next thing I want to do is tighten these nuts. There's a few ways to do that. The ideal way, I believe, is with a socket from overhead going down, but that would require removing the strings, which I do not want to do. A less ideal way, but good in a pinch, is this tool is from a company called ESP. I don't remember where I got it from, maybe Stumac or Sweetwater perhaps. It's got these little ridges. The blue plastic can come off, I just never took it off. This side is slightly bigger than this side. It has little ridges. So what you do is, like, you feed it on there, and when it gets to the size it needs to be, that'll catch. But this is good in a pinch. But I find it does chew the edges, and it will take the coating off, the paint off. So I'm going to use just a regular wrench. Oops, sorry, hit you. This is a 15 millimeter wrench. And I'm just going to grab it ever so carefully. You don't want to kill it, but you do want to snug it. That one was quite loose. I'll do this one. This helps with things not stripping over time from rattling. This helps with your strings staying in tune. This helps with your instrument just being in good shape. I'm surprised they're so loose, because whenever I do a string change, because I did change the strings on these at some point since I've owned it, I wonder, there's so much tension on this neck because it is an H string. I wonder if somehow that, between that and rattling, and then also, I'm telling you, here in New Mexico, it's so dry. I recently bought an instrument, a Greek bouzouki, and I'll show you that at some point. And within a few days of having it here, the fret sprout was incredible. All right. These are all snug. I'm not totally killing them, but I am making sure they're snug. Carefully not to strip the paint or round the corners or to bend any strings. All right, I like that. Again, I'm gonna now double check the little screws on the back. Make sure they're still, because I did see some movement when I was tightening those nuts. Some of these seem to shift ever so slightly. I don't understand how. But all these screws are in good shape. I don't remember, I guess that doesn't screw in. I think maybe just the nut holds it in place. I don't remember. I just don't remember. Okay. Now, last but not least, take that back. Let's flip it back over. Okay, just want to. So the stem here is nice and tight. The head of this is loose. I don't know if you can see that moving. All right. So, I think my tartan is making it hard to see. Stems are tight. Tight, 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 tight. Ooh. So the tuning peg is loose. So now, check this out. I'm gonna lower you down so you can see what I'm talking about. So, look right here. There's a little Phillips head screw there. It's hard to see, but those get loose over time. You don't want to kill those either, but they need to be a little snug. There's also these little plastic collars or spacers there. Those tend to split sometimes, especially if you over tighten it. So now I tighten that. This is tight. Loose. Can you see that? Loose, hang on, show you like this, Ella, oops, I ruined it, hang on, I'm not good at this, all right, hang on, loose, and, tight, okay, just happens over time. I'm going to tighten these two. That one was quite loose. You do have to hold them. Right, hold the head while you turn the screw. I'll do this side as well. I'm somewhat ambidextrous, so it helps, especially when working on things. But again, don't kill this thing. Just snug it down just a little bit. Nice. So these are tight. Oh, that one's... Ooh, that's loose there. I just noticed that one. Nice. I missed it before. Let me get a wrench for that. But all the heads are... The tuning peg heads are tight now. Let me find the right size wrench for that. I'm going to guess 10 millimeter. I was correct. It's a 10 millimeter. Let's just check them all. Ooh, that one's loose. Nice. Again, I'm not killing it, but I want it snug. That one's quite loose. And that one's been hard to wind. I wonder if that has something to do with it. All right, I'm glad I checked them all. They were all a little loose, even though they weren't shaken. Bacon. But they were tight. They were loose, I mean, I'm sorry. They needed tightening. I mix my words up sometimes. I don't know if that means I have an issue. Sometimes, too, I think in two languages. I speak Greek. And words come to me in Greek. All right, tight, tight, like a tiger. Shmeep Shmop is on the fretboard. Let's tune it up, see what happens. So I got you plugged into my MB B30, MB series bass B30. This is a Fender? I don't remember who makes this. Anyway, I like it. It's a little practice amp. I bought it at a thrift store for next to nothing. It's a little beat up on the outside and it didn't have a handle. So I just had this old luggage handle I threw on there. What I like about it is, so you've got two settings, modern and classic, right? Classic, you have gain and volume choices, that's it. As well as then your equalization, you have bass, treble, and then there's this thing called voice shift. So there are these three preset, it's a little crunchy, but it is what it is. Preset sound voicings. And so you choose one of the three by turning this knob. And then the voice knob is how much or little of that voicing you put into your sound. Or if you depress this so the light's red, you're in modern. So what you have is a volume and a compressor, right? And then the compressor, that's your adjustment. And if that starts going red, you know you're clipping. I tend to leave it in a classic mode. Yeah, and then you've got a CD in and the headphones out. This was, I guess, pre-USB or whatever. It's a quarter-inch CD in, which is a little weird, so you need an adapter. But you can play music through here while you're practicing if you're learning songs. I've done that before. Or headphones for quiet practice. All right, let's put you on the stand and tune it up and see what it sounds like and looks like. P.S. If anyone knows, I broke my Snark tuner. There's three little protrusions. One of them broke off, so you can't connect it to the little arm thing anymore. But it was a really good tuner. I bought new ones, but it's a shame. If anyone knows how to fix it, let me know. All right, let's tune this thing up. I got it pretty close. It sounds like a chorus. Around and watch the whole thing. Let me know if you have any questions or comments. I put the links on the screen. I'll put them down below in the description as well. Yeah, any questions you might have too. Thank you for being here. Thank you for watching. and I'll talk to you guys soon at the next video. And I'd like to do more of these musical instrument videos too, if everybody's interested. All right, take care. Talk to you soon.